Hello, and welcome to this webinar from Mind. Today I would like to talk about accelerating product development with an integrated design and simulation environment. This presentation discusses the thermal and fluid analysis capabilities that exist within the suite of NX CAE solutions and how they are seamlessly integrated with NX CAD. This allows your designers to leverage simulation tools within their design environment to ensure you produce the right design the first time. According to many surveys done amongst engineers, the most difficult task when doing simulation is to come up with a fluid domain, particularly with regards to CFD. This domain represents the empty space between many complex shapes and parts. We have done extensive research on the various techniques available, and the one we will be showing today is one of the best methods. One of the key factors why it is the best method is because it remains associative to any CAD design change that will occur later on. Most other techniques do not stay associative to CAD design changes, both at the part level and on the assembly level, and the user needs to constantly recreate the fluid domain. Hence, within NX, your simulation model and fluid domain will update automatically once you have gone through this procedure once and only once, and this is a huge time saver advantage. Here are some of the challenges that we see for analysts. First, there is a high reliance on CAD designers and depending on them to be able to make the design changes, even if sometimes they don't understand the simulation implications. Then there's also the constant recreation of analysis models. Every time the design is changed, the analysis, the loads, the boundary conditions have to be reapplied to the new CAD model because there is no association. Then there is the difficulty obtaining closed fluid volume. Again, this is something that's particular to fluid analysis, given that you have the need to create this empty volume or the negative space. And then there are other challenges as well with regards to the multiphysics workflows, many different steps, perhaps using many different softwares, and with regards to radiated analysis using hydraulic networks. But one of the key advantages within NX is that everything is integrated into one environment. You have CAD and CAE combined, and you can do a lot of different steps together to increase your productivity significantly. Here are some of the key differentiators that we'll be talking about, and we talk about in general. But however, for today, we'll focus mostly on the first three. The first one being this superior built-in direct geometry editing capabilities. And this just illustrates here, again, some of the power of being able to have a CAD package associated to your CAE model. Because traditionally, when a change happens with history-based CADs, you first have to go all through the different steps on the left-hand side, finding a feature, updating, and so forth, fixing downstream, something that the CAD designer has to do. And then this has to be taken into the CAE preprocessor, and that can take hours and days. And you can't necessarily edit these processes and so forth, and there's a challenge. And you have to ask the designer, and there's a lot of productivity loss. But on the right hand side, you can see that using synchronous technologies, which is a direct editing capability, you can quickly make changes and seamlessly have those changes update into the CAE world. Today, we'll show you some of these techniques in the model, as well as using just traditional traditional CAD techniques as well. Another key differentiator, again, is with regards to the seamless design to CAE design to analysis associativity and the comprehensive thermal and flow analysis capabilities that are built in. Over here, you see basically some of the benefits for radiator simulation. And for this particular customer, we could see that the process that took, in fact, part of the challenge was with the large time taken to do the analysis modeling. But time saving could be made up to 90% by reducing the analysis modeling. Again, some of the reasons for this is the fact that we had superior geometry editing capabilities, and also that the analysis models are associated to the base geometry. Finally, particularly to radiated simulation is the ability to use 1D elements. From now on, I'm going to be going through a demonstration and showing you how we can make these edited geometry changes and how everything is seamlessly associated in an integrated environment. Let us now shift to NX and take a look at the model that we have in front of us. This is the air blower with the casing and the rotor blade in an assembly. You can see here the rotor blade as I rotate it. And you can see that it's inside an assembly which has nothing in it. But in this assembly file, We want to generate the air volumes, the negative space, and we want to make sure it's associative. And in this case, we want to hide the original body. So we'll go ahead and create a link using the geometry linker. And we now have two linked bodies inside the assembly. Let me go ahead and just rename them so it's easier for us to look at them after. One for the casing, one for the rotor. And then what we're going to do is we're going to use these bodies to generate the air volume. Let's go ahead and hide the casing link body and start with the rotor blade. So here we're going to use some of the synchronous technology capabilities that I've talked about, where we can quickly make changes without having any information about how the part was built. We want to simplify this part a little bit so we can create the air domain. So let's go ahead and first remove some of these surfaces. And as you can see in the preview, quickly those faces are just automatically removed because the software intelligently knows what to remove. We'll go ahead and remove that and make that just a capped face. And here we have a volume ready to be able to use to create the air volume around this. We're going to extract the geometry, in other words, make an effectively a copy of this, because we're going to use this twice. Once to create the air volume and once to remove air from the air volume generated from the casing, which you will see later on. So now let's go ahead and delete the faces. Now, if you see what happens, it deletes all these faces here automatically. But if I do this icon called All But Selected, it selects everything else. And quickly, in one step, we have now removed effectively the geometry for the rotor, and we're left with the air surrounding it. Now, this step in any other software would take much longer, if at all possible. And let's go ahead and, just for clarity's sake, change the color of the part so that we can make it something that's easier to see, make it translucent so we can recognize that this is air. And here we have now the first air volume, the one for the rotor. Now let's go ahead and hide that, and let's create the second air volume for the casing. So this again is the casing. We'll use the same technique where we want to delete the faces. And of course this deletes all the internal faces, but we want the opposite, all the external faces. And again, within a few clicks, we have now created the air volume. Now, of course, this volume already includes the space for the rotor and for the air volume associated with the rotor, so we want to remove both of them. Again, first, let's go ahead and change the color here so we can see and recognize that this is, in fact, the air volume when we have all the parts together. And that's what we have here. We now have both of them. We have this first one, and what we're going to do is subtract the other geometry. So if you remember, we had created a copy of the rotor geometry, and now we're going to use that to cut it out from this air volume. So let's go ahead and show it, select that rotor geometry, and just say OK. And you can see that this is the geometry that's going to be used, and hit apply. And what you can see here, basically, though it's the same color, is that it's now one body where we've removed all that space, all that volume, that where the rotor resides in this air volume. Now let's go ahead and turn on the other one, which is the negative space, and use that to remove. And so now we've used them both. We'll hide the initial bodies, and we now have this volume. So again, let's go ahead and change some of the colors so you can see what I'm talking about, and see that we now have the second air volume. So here in a few steps, we've created these two air volumes, a step that during any traditional design techniques, or even if you were analysis, where you would have to depend on the CAD designer, would take you a significant amount of time. So now we can go ahead and go more into the analysis because we've created these air volumes. So again, I now show you both the two air volumes that we've created in a few minutes here. Now let's show this in context of the rest of the assembly. So let's go ahead and go back to the assembly navigator and turn on the rotor blade and the casing. And here we have, you see, the original components, which is the rotor and the casing, and the air volumes associated with it. Now the design portion is done. Let's go ahead into advanced simulation and start analyzing this. So we'll jump into the simulation, and again, in one environment, you don't have to jump to another product. We can go from the part file and directly create the finite element model and the simulation data. In this case, we're going to use thermal flow to do a flow analysis. And as you can see at the top, it's saying creating CAE body. It's generating the geometry to be used in the CAE world. And we're now inside the simulation navigator in the simulation environment. And here we come up with the solution. So again, this is what we're going to use to solve. Let's rename it and call it 2500 RPM. And this is in fact the speed at which the rotor blade is going to be rotating. And we'll use the advanced flow package. And you can see here within this solution parameters page, there's lots of different parameters we can select. We've selected a certain turbulence model, high speed flow, and there's a lot of versatility that exists here to do many different types of analysis. So now that we've created that, let's just go ahead and jump to the simulation file and start creating some of these loads and boundary conditions for this specific model. We can always go back and create the mesh and the material properties after. So first, let's go ahead and define the opening, where the air is coming in. So we're going to go ahead and call this the inlet and select one of the top faces of the air body, the one of the blue faces. And the conditions, again, are ambient air temperature. So it's coming from air, is coming from ambient air. And just hit apply. So now we've associated that. We've defined that that face has that as the inlet. Now we're going to go ahead and we're going to switch to the outlet. So again, the face that you're looking at in front of you is going to be the outlet stress, where the air has been sped up by the rotor blade and is coming out at a higher velocity. Say OK, apply that. There we go. So once we've done these two, there's one more boundary condition that we need to do, one more load in a sense that we have to do. And that's to create the represent the rotor blade rotating. And we can use that using what is called a rotating frame of reference. So we'll go ahead here and we'll say moving frame of reference, and you can choose different types, whether it's, in this case, we want it to be rotating. Again, let's rename it. So it's a rotating frame of reference of the air that's rotating at 2500 RPM. And again, because it's rotating, it needs to have an axis around it, which is axis. Around which it rotates. So we'll just make sure we're selecting the right body, in this case the rotor blade, and you can use the top face and say normal to that face is the face to which we're going to provide the axis. So the axis is that, except we'll do it the other way around, so it rotates in the correct direction. And again, select a point. We can just select one of the top points, the arc center of the top face. And then finally, what we're going to do is we're going to give it a rotation rate. In this case, 2500. And of course, we need to change the units to revolutions per minute. And here we have it. Here we've basically fully defined from a simulation perspective the model. We then need to go ahead and jump back into the FEM file and create the mesh. Again, we can show all the polygon bodies to see what we've done, but here we are jumping back to the FEM. And once we jump back to FEM, we just quickly need to create a mesh mating condition. Of course, what that means is that we have these two, as we're highlighting here in orange, two bodies that exist, and they're going to be meshed independently, but we want to make sure that the nodes coincide between both bodies. And so we have this quick capability called automatic creation of mesh mating. In other words, ensuring that all the nodes on both faces are matching. And here the software again automatically recognizes the two faces. In this case, it's two sets of, well, it's a set of cylindrical faces. It's matching the faces, and then once that's done, we can go ahead and mesh. Okay, so that's done now. Now let's go ahead and create the mesh finally. And here we are, we're going to just create a tetrahedral mesh. We'll give it a element size of, say, 10 millimeters. And we just want to make sure that we capture all the features. So we're going to ensure that with the model cleanup options below, that we just have an increased tolerance of the small feature size. So we'll go ahead and say OK to 10 millimeters. And we'll go down and say, you know, decrease the tolerance so that we can have enough tolerance to be able to effectively model the entire geometry, particularly in some areas where there's some small edges and so forth. And with that we say okay, and we let the system automatically generate the models. So as you can see, there's a number of automated steps here, automated from the perspective of creating the modifying the changes to CAD with no history, automated ability to create the mesh mating conditions, and also the automated ability to quickly create your meshes as well. And of course, everything is associative. And as you will see, and as I showed you in the first image on the slide, once we make a design change, all these things will propagate. A design change on the casing will make a design change on the air volume, which will then make a design change on the mesh, and therefore automatically update, and you can rerun your results. And this is a very powerful capability within NXCAE. So we're done here. You can just say OK, and we're basically fully defined this geometry. The last thing we need to do is just give it a material property. Of course, this is air, and so we need to ensure that we define the material property for this fluid domain. And we'll just go ahead and, again, seamlessly you have a basic library of materials that exist inside of NX, so you don't have to worry about the properties and so forth. Everything is built in, but of course, if you have your own properties, it's easy for you to add and change it into the NXCAE environment and include it in there. We'll go back to the simulation file now that we're done with everything in the FEM file, and we're basically now ready to run a solve. We'll go ahead and make some changes to the solver parameters. Again, to the 3D solver, we can change some of the time steps. Change some of the momentum equations. And again, you can see here that there's a lot of different capabilities that exist, to a lot of versatility in running the analysis. So now that the solve has been complete, we can go ahead and take a look at some of the results. Here we are in the simulation post-processing navigator, and we're going to take a look at the velocity results for this model. We can quickly apply a template which sets up all the different types of display properties that we want to look at the results. In this case, we have a banded display that clearly shows the demarcation between the different speeds here. And as we animate it, we can see that there is blue, which represents the cold spots, or in other words, where the velocity is slowing down. So we can also take a slice here and take a look and zoom in different levels and see exactly what is going on where. And you can see that indeed there's some areas near the fan that it's red, therefore there's high speed velocity, which was what we're expecting. But what we also see is that basically the neck that exists, you know, if this looks like a 9, basically on the left hand side, you can see that basically the sharp edge, and that sharp edge is I think causing some issues there because the air is really restricted there. But what we can also take a look at and look at here is try to create streamlines. And streamlines is a powerful capability, particularly with fluid analysis, is the ability to look at see how particles are flowing with inside the air volume. But what we need to do is create a seed set, create some seeds, and select some nodes in which where the air is flowing. And as you can see, as we're selecting here, we can select different seeds on different cut planes and different levels. You start seeing these blue lines which represent how the air is flowing at these different nodes. And we'll go ahead and take it to certain different levels. And you can start to see clearly that the air is circulating in a clockwise direction. But what you start to see here, again, in this area where we're picking right now, is some really interesting shapes. So I've sped ahead because I don't want to spend all the time clicking through all the parts, and we can take a look at the streamlines here and see what it looks like. So what we see here is when we start animating these streamlines, is you can clearly see the motion of the particles going in a clockwise direction. But you can also see that there's a significant amount of blue bubbles, which represents that there's basically a pressure loss that's happening there. There's a velocity, significant velocity drop. And this could affect the design, and this could actually start having pressure on the casing itself. So maybe what we need to do here is maybe make a design change on the casing. And indeed, that's probably what we're going to have to have done, is make a design change and take a look at the results again and see what happens. See if we can reduce this So the way we're going to reduce this constriction is to go back into the design model, into the CAD model, and try to make some design change quickly around that neck. So we'll go ahead and go back to the I part, the idealized part, and then jump ahead back down all the way to the actual assembly file. And again, this is where we're going to show you that we have a significant advantage versus other competitive products out there, is because of the integrated solution, we can make a design change here and everything is going to propagate. So we're going to go ahead and go back and just hide the air volumes and only show you the rotor blade and the air casing. In fact, we'll even just make the casing the work part, the part in which we're going to modify. And in that area where I've just selected is where we want to make a change. And what we will do is we will add a fillet here. So we'll add a fillet so we can change the design so it makes it a bit more rounded so that the air is not so constricted as it's rotating around and hitting that wall. So we'll go ahead and select some of the faces. We're just going to select some of these outside faces and create a face blend. So we'll select one set of faces here, including that small one at the bottom, change the direction of it so that we ensure that the blend is going in the right direction. Select the second set of faces, and you can see the preview here of what it's going to look like. And now we're done. We say OK, and we let it run. And as you can see with the blue bar, it's updating everything and all the other geometry. Now we also have to do this on the inside. So let's go ahead and do the same steps for the inside. And what's happening here is while we make this change, everything is updating. The air volume, and so forth. And as we go into the CAE world, the mesh and everything will update as well. And this is a huge time savings that you can quickly make a study and change and see what would happen if I made this design change. And then of course later you could always tell your designer, well, I need to actually make this design change and I've reviewed it and it actually would give me better results. So here we have, we've gone ahead and make this change. And so you can see this nice fillet here. So it's not as constricted as having that sharp edge there. We'll go back into the assembly and turn on the air volumes. And for illustration purposes, we're just going to hide the casing. Now you can see, okay, the color of the face has changed, but you can see this basically one air volume, which now already incorporates the change. So this is the first step where it's powerful, is that this air volume that we've generated before is now automatically updated. So now we'll go ahead and go back into the simulation file and update the rest of the model. So we go back into the FEM file, and what's going to happen is the software is now going to automatically start updating the body. As you can see at the top, it says the body is modified and do an update. And it'll just give you an information window indicating that something is not modified. So we'll go ahead and take a look at the mesh here. Now if we hide the polygon geometry, however, what you see is that the mesh hasn't changed shape. And here we could see if you click on the update icon, just now new thing appears, the model starts to update. So you had the previous mesh, and here the software recognizes that there's been a design change and seamlessly, automatically updates the mesh. So it's going to go through and it's going to remesh it. But the advantage here is that all the faces that were selected for all the boundary conditions and the loads, like the inlet, the outlet, and the rotating frame, everything is intelligently associated. So any change that happens does not affect that. So here the mesh is done and it updates. And you can see now that it's incorporated the fillet into the model. And again, like I said, what we can do here is we can quickly make a copy of it. So we want to keep the old results because we want to compare them after. And we can run a solve with this new model and see what happens. Here we've done the solve on this copy of this solution, and we can take a look at the results. What we'll do, however, is that we're going to show both models side by side, and we can show the two models with two viewports here, which is something, again, that's very powerful in the post-processing capabilities inside of NX. So we will go ahead and load the velocity results for both models, select which window. So in the left window, the new results, And in the right window, the old results. And you can see that the meshes are slightly different. We can also synchronize the views so that anything we happen in one model in one viewport also changes in the other viewport. Then what we'll do is we'll go ahead and again quickly, because we have these predetermined templates, just change the view, selecting both of them and making them both banded results. Now let's zoom in and see and take a look at the results here. You can see that, of course, the design is slightly different, and I think the results are different as well. You can see that the maximum velocity is different between the two models. We can go ahead and animate both the models. Let's go ahead and select both of them and animate it again. And you can see how the results are changing here. This gives you an indication definitely that there's a difference here, and if we look in that neck area, I think it's the flow is significantly different. But let's go ahead and take a cut section again and see in a bit more detail what is happening. So we can show the hidden bodies to give you an idea of the air volume and see the change. And we can see. So of course there still is that blue spot, that blue area where there's a significant amount of velocity loss. But the more interesting thing is around the rotor blades, that I guess it's getting more green. In other words, the velocity is increasing. So there's less of a constriction around the rotor blades. So this might achieve the design, this design change might achieve what we wanted it to do. I hope this simple demonstration illustrates the power of NX for CE analysis. The main message I'd like to leave you with is the fact that it is easy to create associative fluid domains for the most complex parts and assembly profiles, and also that complete meshing, thermofluid, and advanced CFD simulation capabilities are built into one integrated solution. And of course, as you've seen, that there are amazing post-processing and reporting capabilities that allow you to quickly get the results you want out of your model.